He was one of the very last Africans to be taken into slavery in the United States, and the only known African Muslim to have left an autobiography in Arabic about his years in captivity while he was still a slave. In 1807, Omar ibn Sayyid, a 37-year-old Muslim scholar, was captured by an invading African army in Senegal and sold to slave traders. He was taken from his village in Futatoro to St. Louis Port, where he was sold into slavery. St. Louis is an island at the mouth of the Senegal River that played an important role in the transit of slaves from African countries to the Americas and the Caribbean. This region was one of the main sectors of the so-called triangular trade, which consisted of Europeans coming to West Africa to exchange manufactured goods, like textiles and weapons, in return for slaves. Then the enslaved Africans were loaded onto boats and taken to the Americas, after which the boats would return back to Europe, loaded with raw materials like sugar, tobacco, and cotton. These transatlantic crossings saw at least 10 to 12 million people being transported to the Americas as slaves from the 16th to the 19th centuries. Only the stories of a few have been preserved, and Ibn Sayyid's is one of them. Ibn Sayyid was taken into slavery in 1807, a year before the abolishment of the slave trade took effect in the US, and died in 1864, just 1 year before slavery was finally abolished. His story has come to prominence 150 years after his death, when his memoir was added to the US Library of Congress in 2017. Before Ibn Sayyid's abduction, he was an intellectual who spent more than two decades of his life studying the Quran and other subjects in his home country. Throughout 15 handwritten pages, Ibn Sayyid's memoir challenges the historical slave narrative about African traditions and culture. His memoir begins with a chapter from the Quran, Surah Al-Mulk, with the verses speaking about dominion, sovereignty or ownership, and the conveying of an overarching message that only God has ownership of creation. The verses, according to experts, could be understood as a message to the slave owners and slave culture prevalent at the time. Then Ibn Sayyid proceeds to tell his own story.
My name is Umar ibn Sayyid. My birthplace was Futatoro, between the two rivers. I sought knowledge under the instruction of a sheikh called Muhammad Sayyid, my own brother Sheikh Suleiman Kembe, and Sheikh Gabriel Abdal. I continued my studies 25 years, and then returned to my home where I remained for 6 years. Then there came to our place a large army, who killed many men and took me and brought me to the Great Sea, and sold me into the hands of the Christians, who bound me, sent me on a board, a great ship, and we sailed upon the Great Sea a month and a half, when we came to a place called Charleston in the Christian language. There they sold me to a small, weak, and wicked man called Johnson, a complete infidel who had no fear of God at all.
Ibn Sayyid eventually ran away from his first owner in Charleston, South Carolina, to Fayetteville, North Carolina, before he was arrested and sold again. But this time, according to his memoir, his new owner, James Owen, was different. Historians who studied Ibn Sayyid's memoir and other documents are of the opinion that Ibn Sayyid spent the rest of his life with the Owen family, who were affiliated with the American Colonization Society, a group that was formed in 1817 to send free African Americans to Africa as an alternative to emancipation in the United States. The group sent thousands of Africans to Liberia.
The northern abolitionists and the southern slave plantation owners, there was a middle way, as they called it, and that middle way was colonization, namely convincing as many slave owners to release slaves or buying them and then sending them to Liberia. And those particular people were not universally, it seems, interested in all slaves. They were particularly drawn to men of culture and education, like Omar was.
Ibn Sayyid's skills and intellect made him a well-known person in the entourage, and when he died, a local newspaper published an obituary praising him as a pious Christian, which was unusual in 19th century America. Which takes us to another point that makes Ibn Sayyid's memoir remarkable. Although Ibn Sayyid wrote in his memoir that he converted to Christianity, experts analyzing his memoir say otherwise.
It's one of the things that a number of Muslims did, you know, that's pseudo-conversion. In some countries, they were just forced, and they externally, if you will, conform to that. And then, you know, they actually remain Muslims.
the fact that he was, that the opacity of his narrative, when he opens it, for example, by a particular surah from the Quran, that seemed to me to be included as a kind of a message, a hidden message, that his owners had no right over him, that the possession and power all inheres in the hands of God. That this seemed to be to kind of go against the narrative of his conversion, right, or of his slavery itself.
But whether his conversion was real or was a facade for protection like many enslaved Africans in the 19th century, Ibn Said's memoir stands as an important document for the history and narrative of African heritage in the United States.
The whole operation of the slave trade depended upon willfully neglecting the origins of enslavement. And that's one of the reasons why a text like Omar's is so important, because it recovers that suppressed history. And slavery is a silencer. It denies the voices of captive Africans and enslaved people in the Americas. So recovering this text is so important to getting that history back and understanding the lies and violence that were really at the root of the Atlantic slave trade.